So let's start today's session. I'll share my screen. Okay, the recording has been started. Okay. So, where were we last time? So we looked into client scripts, we looked into user events, we looked at suitelet, we even looked at schedule script. And I told you guys that within schedule script there are two things which I'll let you know. So what are schedule scripts? Remember last time we've seen schedule scripts are nothing but scripts that trigger at a particular time, at a particular schedule that we provide. And also there's talent, there are three things, right? In three ways they can be triggered. One, they can be called by any other script, right? Any user event or suitelet. Two, it's a schedule. If a schedule is set, according to the schedule, the script will be triggering. And three, whenever we want, we can just trigger the script manually too. So, what is there within a schedule script? So when the script is triggered at a particular point of time, based upon the logic, and I told you most of the times, 99% of times, schedule scripts start with a save search. So if we use a search, we get something like some records, and then on it we perform our business logic and do whatever we need to do. So what are those two things which I said? I'll let you guys know. So the first thing is, as I told you, there is firstly we use a save search within a schedule script. So in NetSuite, when you go and create a save search, okay, let's see, do we have any saved searches created by our team, employee reviews data? Do we have any? Looks like these are all standard save searches. So when you create any save search, you'll get a lot of results, right? So your results may vary. You may have like 10 results or 100 results or 1000 results or even 100,000 results. So why I brought up this point is, okay, let's see this employee search view. Okay, see, you have only 5 results here. So for some searches, there may be thousands of results. And when this search is called by a script, okay, or else within script we are creating a search like this, okay, within script, how do we create search within script? This is our main line, okay. We first write NLAP search record, okay, and we are searching on any custom record. We are putting some filters and columns. So filters should always say, okay, where variable filters is equal to new array, and within that you need to provide your criteria. Okay, here there are three criteria if you see the script. One is, okay, this field should be false, and this field value we are setting something, okay, and this field value is this something, okay. And then even columns, you always do, okay, where variable columns is equal to new array, and within columns, what are fields do you need from that results? You select all those fields. So remember, you should always have internal ID, okay, and it's better to set sort or what is the set sort? If you go to any save search, okay, edit the search. If I have to show you, okay, this filter, where do you put this filter? Employee status thing, you put over here within the filters, okay. And then what do you have under columns? Under columns is nothing but your results, result fields. Go here, these all are your result fields, okay. And then what is this set sort? Set sort is nothing but this one, okay. You're sorting by name, okay, it's like that. Sort by internal ID, that's what this code says. So whenever you're creating a search within script, or else you are loading the search, you can even load this search. For example, how do you load this search? I'll write the line here. So if you want to load the search, okay, variable something ABC, okay, what is this variable ABC? You're putting all the search results should be inside this variable, okay. Okay, variable ABC, how do you load a search? Already created one, NLAPI, load search, okay. So and load search, in this first you need to put the type, okay. What is the type of this search you're loading? Let's see, what is this search? Employee search, okay, this search type is employee. Good. You can try the type. If it's a transaction search, you should write transaction, okay, employee. And then you have to give the search ID. What is the search ID? This one, custom search A3873, sorry. So this should be the ID. So if you give this, what happens? What does this statement execute? This will just load this already created search in NetSuite. Okay, so either you can load a already created search from within NetSuite, or else you can directly create a search. Okay, this thing, it's not there in NetSuite. Okay, this is directly created from the script itself. So for either of these, okay, when you're doing from the script, the results that you get only 1,000. So they're limited to 1,000. So whenever you are creating a search in script, it may be a direct search from script, or it may be calling a already created save search, but the results will return only 1,000. You can say, okay, here you're calling this search, inside NetSuite this search may have like 2,000 results. Yes, it may have 2,000 results, but when the same search is loaded by the script, it will only get 1,000. So that's a limitation within Suite script. So how do you come around that limitation? And whenever you're taking some, I don't think vendors will ask you this question, but when you're taking client calls, if they get deep inside, like asking you more technical questions, they will certainly ask you this question. Hey, you said, do you write schedule scripts? You'll say, yes, I've written schedule scripts. Then they'll ask, okay, within schedule script, can you create a search? They'll say, yes, you can create a search, or you can load already create a search within NetSuite. Then they'll say, okay, how many results will you get? If you say, okay, we'll get all the results, then you are caught there itself. So you should say, or you can, it results, it returns only 1,000 results initially. Then we have a workaround where we can get all the results, however size it may be. Even if it's like 100,000 records or 500,000 records, we should get all the results. So what is that workaround? See, this is the workaround. Okay, this part is the workaround. So what do we do? Okay, look at this one. Okay, this search, all the results will come into this variable called results one. Okay, now what's happening? Okay, is all the results he's setting into another variable. Okay, good, complete results set one. Okay, and then what is doing? Okay, while results dot length is equal to 1,000, yes, results, it returns only 1,000 in the first place. Okay, while this is equal to 1,000, what is he doing? He's saying, okay, get last ID. So this results is getting 999. So because it starts from 0, he's getting the last one, okay, which is 999. Is getting get value internal ID, and make sure all the time internal ID should be in the columns. Okay, if you don't put internal ID in the columns, then your script will not work. Okay, so it's getting the internal ID of the last 1,000th record that this results one gets. Okay, it's getting the internal ID here, and then what is it doing? He's again creating a search. He's again creating a search on the same thing. Okay, this whole thing is repeating. Okay, whole thing is again repeating, and then what is he doing to the filters? He's adding one more filter. Okay, and remember, when you write this filter, this number should always okay, here filters there, this 1, 2, 3, okay, it ends at 2, then here it should be 3, it should not be 2, okay, it should be 3. So make sure the filters is incremental, 0, 1, 2. Now you're adding one more filter, it should be 3 here. Okay, and what is the filter you're adding? You're saying internal ID number. Don't worry if this is not present in the columns. Okay, internal ID number greater than last ID. So what is this? So the internal ID of the 1,000th record. Okay, so this search will again do perform on the same custom record. I mean, it can be custom record, it can be any transaction. Here it's an employee record, right? Employee record, it can be any. So we need to give the same thing. If we are writing this code for this, okay, for this load search, the same thing here, it will be load search. Here you'll get load search. Actually, sorry, you won't get load search. You need to write search record, because load search parameters are only these two. So even if you're writing for this, even if the save search is already present in NetSuite and you're calling that save search within your script, even then for the workaround, you'll always write search record again. Okay, search record, and here what you'll do, employee, and then you'll get the internal ID over here in the null. Second one is internal ID. Okay, employee, and you'll get given internal ID. And now you're adding your filter, which says, okay, the filter should be internal ID number should be greater than the 1,000th record. So from 1,001 record internal ID, you'll get all those. So all the records whose internal ID is greater than 1,000th record internal ID will be coming into results. And those results, you're concatenating with the initial results. So initial results of 1,000 will be in this, right? So rest all, when you're getting, those all will be coming inside this results one over here. and then you're concatenating the first 1000 with the rest of the values, rest of the results, and then everything is now under this complete result set one. Okay, that's why I'm saying here log execution total, it should be total search results. Okay, these parameters, it's up to us, we can give any data, any string. So total search results, and it will be this one. Okay, so we have everything, all the results. It may be 10,000 records, so this will have 10,000 records. Your log will show 10,000 records as a result. Okay, and where you see the logs, if you forgot, you see the logs at execution log tab on your script. Okay, over here you'll see all the logs. So this is one thing, that whenever you have a search in your schedule script, the search will certainly result return only 1000 records at once. In order to get all the results, what you do, you just use this while loop. Okay, this is while loop, and then you get rest of, after 1000 records, how many records you have, you'll get all those using this second search API, and then you just concatenate all those results with your first 1000 results. Okay, hence you'll get all the complete results. So this is one way, and there is, and this will work in most of the cases. Okay, but there may be some scenarios where the save search will not be direct. It might be like very complicated save search. You'll be using a lot of formulas and a lot of things. In that scenario, it will certainly fail. I mean, not fail. Your this while loop may not work. And even when you say, when the client, like on the interview, if he asks you, okay, how are you going to get all your results, not only 1000, then you'll say, okay, I'll use a while loop. I'll put the last internal ID up to 1000 record, and I'll again run a search so that I'll get all those internal IDs greater than 1000 record internal ID, and then I'll concatenate with the first 1000. You can say that, okay, fine. He'll take that answer, but he'll say, why are you doing this? There may be any other method. Yes, certainly there are few other methods. Like for example, let me see if I can get that other method. I don't see that. There's another script which I just created today. Okay, what happens when that, if that save search is very complex? Look at this script. Okay, this script I just wrote it today. Okay, it's really fresh and I tested it. It works. So look at here. I'm doing a load search. Okay, this is already loading a save search from NetSuite. Okay, and that save search, it is very complicated save search. Okay, so you're loading the search, and then what is, okay, if the search results are not null, then okay, this is a they might say, hey, you can use search.runSearch. You may get all results, but no, you won't get all results. Okay, search.runSearch.getResults, and inside bracket, it's 0 to 1000. They might say, hey, you can use this. You can use this search.runSearch.getResults, but even that will result give you only 1000. Okay, it won't give you more than 1000. So for that, we write this while, okay, and this only, this for simple 99%, 99 times out of 100 times, this while loop will work. Only in rare cases where the save search is too way damn complex, okay, in that scenarios, what you do is this one. When the search results are not null, okay, fine, then you take a variable saying, okay, run search. Now this variable get only 1000 records, okay, right? Here in search, you'll have only 1000 records initially. And okay, you're doing, okay, on those 1000 records, run search. Okay, fine, you're running search, and that will be in search results. Next, you take few variables, like, okay, take an index 0, take an index 1000, and take a result set, and take an array. Okay, now you use do and while loop. Okay, there you did only while loop. Okay, here do and while. This is important. See what is happening in this do while. Okay, this result set. Okay, this is a variable, temporary array we took. Okay, it's not array, it's a variable actually. Okay, temporary variable, and it is equal to search results dot get results. Okay, this is search results, we have 1000 in it. Get results, okay, index is 0, index plus step, 0 plus 1000 is 1000. Okay, so it says, okay, get me all the results from 0 to 1000. Fine, whatever is there in search results, we get it. Okay, we're getting the 1000, first 1000 result set. And then what we're doing, okay, then it says for, it's using a for loop, and it says, okay, variable rs in result set. Okay, it will always be there. Okay, this I got it from Google, these two lines. Okay, so you're doing variable rs in result set. There is r and s. Okay, in result set, r and s are present. You can see r and s are there. And then you're saying result sets. Result sets is nothing but here we took an array. Okay, in this array, what are we pushing? push result set of RS. Okay, so result set of RS is nothing but this result set. RS is present result set, so result set of RS push all those values to this result sets. Okay, so this line, it gets the first 1000, and the first 1000 is pushed into this result sets. Okay, and then it says increase your pointer. Since your pointer is 0 and 1000 here, right? Okay, it increases. So now what happens? Result index, we are increasing it to, we are adding this both. So it's 1000. Result index now becomes 1000. Okay, next time when it comes here, result index is 1000, and 1000 plus 1000 is 2000. So next time, it is going to get you results from 1000 to 2000. And it's going to be repetitive. You'll get 2000 to 3000, 3000 to 4000. And when will it stop? Here on the while loop, you are saying result set dot length is greater than 0. So this is your result set, right? Result set. So when this result set gets no values, then this block will stop functioning. Understood? So this only you need to use it when your save search is very complex, and that scenario you'll encounter only once in 100 times. Okay, in that case you need to use this do and while. Here you'll say, okay, get me the first 1000, and then push those 1000 into an array. And then your criteria will be incremental, then 1000 to 2000, 2000 to 3000. So you'll be getting all those results and you'll be pushing into this array until you'll get zero result into this result set. Okay. And then at the bottom here, I have log execution saying, okay, result sets dot length. Result sets is the array. Okay. Maybe I shouldn't have given similar sounding words, or else you can. But anyways, you'll have this recording. So you can open this recording, you can look into this blog, and you can try to understand what's happening in this block. And this is only 1 out of 100 times, but most of the times, I mean 99 out of 100, this thing will work, just this 5 lines of code. While result dot length is equal to 1000, you can get the 1000th internal ID and again run a search where you want all the records that are coming after the 1000th record, and you concatenate all of them. So 99 times this will work. Okay, this is one thing. And there's another thing in schedule scripts where you always have issue. Okay, now I need to tell you about a thing called governor limits. When you have a vendor call or a client call, you may come across a question asking, do you know what is a governor limit in NetSuite? Okay, so governor limits are the limitations. Like NetSuite, it can't perform everything. It cannot be infinite. There's nothing infinite in NetSuite. So for everything, there are limits. So even for scripting, there are limits. Okay, what are the limits in scripting? It's called units, scripting units. So whenever you write an API, NL API get field value, it consumes some units. Okay, so where do you get to know more about it? Get into help and click on and type governor limits. Governor limit, non limitations, not this one, governance. Is the spelling right for governor? API governance, good. So, look at this. If you want to know about governance, just click on API governance in help. See what's happening here. Whenever you use an API, units are being consumed, okay? Unit usage per API. So see, when are using units like NL API delete file, 20 units are consumed. What are the basic ones? Can you see any basic ones here? If you don't see an API here, then it's not consuming unit. It's a free API. Okay. See, all other APIs are zero. So NL API load search file. Do you have NL API create search anywhere? NL API search record. Okay. NL API search record. It consumes 10 units, so it's like that. NL API submit record, when used on standard transactions 20, on standard non-transactions 10, when used on custom records 4, it's like, look at this, units. So, whenever you write a script, all your APIs, they consume units, okay? Some may be free units, but because we can't see NL API get field value, I don't see get field value here. So that's a free API. So, whenever you're using these APIs, they consume units, and for all your script types, we have only 1000 units available. So what are the script types we have? Again, I'll go to scripts and I look into filter. So for all this, suitelet, restlet, user event, you have 1000 units. For client, portlet, mass update, workflow action, bundle installation, map reduce, all these have only 1000 units. So you can use your APIs, and those APIs, when they consume units, you need to make sure they are all under 1000 units, okay? And the only exception is a schedule script. Schedule script has 10,000 units, okay? Schedule scripts have 10,000 units. So most of the times, if a user-driven script is using most, it's using all the units, and if it's it has a lot of functionality within a user, within it, the user event script, simply we call a schedule script from the user event. We pass on parameters or whatever, and schedule script does all the logic. Just because schedule script has 10,000 units, okay? Now, and also I told you, we use integration. Even schedule scripts are better for integration. That is why, because schedule script has 1000 units. And as earlier, we used to use RESTlet script for integration. RESTlet, even RESTlet script has only 1000 units, okay? Only schedule script has 10,000 units. That's why we always try to use schedule script for, if our requirement is huge, if the business requirement is little complicated, complex, or lot of things we are doing in it, then certainly we'll find a way to use schedule script, okay? Or else we use all the rest of the scripts. And you, and I told you how do schedule script are triggered. One, either by calling, called by a user event or suitlet. Secondly, on a schedule, okay, setting up a schedule, then it gets triggered. Thirdly, whenever you want, you can manually trigger it. But manually triggering, certainly you won't do it in production. Okay, doesn't make sense. So only while testing, you do it a manual trigger, okay? And within schedule script, you have 10,000 units. And let me tell you this. Even 10,000 units are not enough for schedule script. That's true. Even 10,000 units are not at all enough for schedule scripts. You may have a huge functionality which you will write a schedule script for, and you will test the schedule script. It may fail. It may fail and it will throw you an error called execution limit exceeded. Okay, that will be the error called execution limit exceeded. So what does that error means? Which means the 10,000 units have been consumed. You are out of units. So in order to overcome that, so we even have a workaround for that. So when schedule script has 10,000 units, you may consume all of them, but and then if you consume all of them, it will throw you an error. So, and the script will fail, script will stop its execution there itself. So in order to overcome that, we have a workaround. What we do, it's simple. If we are nearing 10,000 units, we refresh the script. I mean, refresh the units, it's not the script. We refresh our 10,000 units and you'll get new 10,000 units. And how to do that? It's just three lines of code. So always in a schedule script at the top, you need to write this, okay? Where variable context is equal to NLAPI get context, okay? Remember this, NLAPI get context, you need to write all this. Let's see if get context consumes any APIs. Get context. Context. No, good. Context doesn't consume any API. Then what? So always you need to write at the top of your schedule script, variable context is equal to NLAPI get context. Next. This is a five lines of code, okay, three or five. So what do you write inside this? If your context dot get remaining usage, okay, get the remaining units. If your context, if your remaining units are less than 2500, okay, this is, it's up to you. You can put 2500 or you can put 3000 or you can go until 500 or 1000, but I prefer to say 2500, okay, so that I want to consume 75% of that units and then I want to refresh it. When you refresh, you won't get 2500 plus 10,000. No, you will get only 10,000 whenever you refresh, okay? So at 2500, what I'm doing is, okay, if units are less than 2500, then it comes into this block, okay? What is it doing? It throws a log execution, okay? Script yielding, okay? That's what we call refreshing the units. It's called yielding. So here what we do, NLAPI set recovery point. So this line is setting a recovery point. Okay, here we need to recover from here. And then NLAPI yield script. So yield script is nothing but refresh the script. Okay, so script will refresh from this recovery point. These two APIs, remember them. NLAPI set recovery point and NLAPI yield script. So whenever someone asks you, hey, how many units are there in schedule script? You'll say 10,000, all others have only 1,000. Okay, you scored a point. Next, you'll say, okay, what if 10,000 units are not enough? Then what will you do? Then you'll say, yes, I know the what you are saying. If 10,000 units are consumed, you will get an error saying execution limit exceeded. In order to overcome that, we have a workaround. What we do is, we check the remaining usage, remaining units, and then we yield a script with a recovery point. That's what you need to say in the interview. Okay? And what will they ask next? No, that should be enough. That answer should be enough. And once this three lines of code executes, you'll have 10,000 units of script. Okay, yeah, they may ask you, okay, where will you place this inside your script? How will you know where will you place? There's no perfect answer for this. What I say is, I'll place it at multiple points. Multiple points, wherever I feel, I'll just place it. For example, I'll show you a script which I wrote today, okay? This is a script which I wrote today, okay? Let's see where all I place this. Okay, recovery point. See, I placed this script here. And very soon I placed it again here. And see, I even placed it again here. So this script is lucky because I placed it only 3 times. But there are some scripts where I placed like 15, 20 times. And there's nothing wrong in that. If you place it like 15, 20 places in a script, and someone looking at your code say, why are you putting all this, why are you writing these 3 lines of code each and everywhere? Then your answer should be, you may run out of units anywhere. At any point of time in the script, it can get run out of units. And he can say, why don't you keep calculating at each and every line how many units are getting consumed, right? Because you have the data. You have on which API consumes what data. So they might say, hey, why don't you go to each and every line? That you don't have that much time. No developer will have that much time going to each and every line, see all the APIs that we are using. And also when you have for loop, okay, for loop in the sense is nothing but the for loop will be repeating again and again until the condition, okay. For loop, this is syntax, this is the initialization for for loop. The next is your condition, okay, and then is your incremental, okay, incrementing. So until this condition is met, this for loop will be running. And when the condition fails, for loop will not get inside and it will proceed with further after the for loop. So sometimes you can't figure out how many times the for loop will be triggering. So if you have APIs inside the for loop, then forget it. You can't calculate how many APIs this script is going to use. So that's the reason. You can say all these reasons. Due to all these reasons, it's better to place wherever you feel like multiple times in the script. Okay. Here I placed 3 times in this script. So what is that 4 lines? This, remember this, okay? You should always place the context at the beginning and then, or else you can do even this. NLP get context, you can just take this one, Control C, instead of context, here you can place this, okay? NLP get context dot get remaining usage less than 2500, okay? And then your 3 lines are this. But I don't prefer this, I always prefer to put context, okay? Context dot get remaining usage. Log execution and use when this is better. This can help you out when you look at the logs. If you see this line script dealing, then you can identify, okay, this is where this if statement satisfied because it had less than 2500 units and the script has yielded. Okay, so this is the other thing which is important in schedule scripts. Okay, now schedule scripts are done. Let's look further. What do we have? As I told you, today we'll finish portlet and mass update script, and tomorrow we'll look into workflows and workflow action scripts. Okay, so portlets and mass update, interesting. First, let's look at portlet script. As I told you, what is a portlet script? On the dashboard, you'll get something like this. You'll create something like this. I have an example. Let me show you that example, which I've written like 2 years back or last year. See, I've written the script June 11, 2015. In first anniversary has passed by. Okay, so I've written this script. Oh, now you. Okay. It will be. Okay, this is your function. Okay, this is your portlet function. Even if you get into your portlet, customization, scripting, scripts. Let's see if we have portlet scripts in this honeycomb. Yes, there are a few. So if you're going to do, you see, even here there's only function. There are no like before load, after submit, there are nothing like that. Similar to schedule and suitlet, there's just a function. So within that function, what are we writing? Okay. We're just creating an object. Object is nothing but the dashboard thing. And we're setting title saying, okay, RMS backdating and defaulting AR account, something, okay. Something blah blah. Then okay, we are putting a field. Okay, add a field, select date, okay, and that set layout type, okay, normal, okay, start column, okay. So this field starts the column, so it's going downward, it's not going second, I mean, it's to second column. Then, okay, field 2, giving any internal ID, okay, type is select, and this is the label of the field, and it's a custom list, okay. And then second, even the three fields, you can see here three fields are created. All three fields, they are select fields, the labels are given, and they're all custom lists, okay. And then it's creating one more field, okay, this checkbox, okay, it's called enable. And then what is it creating? It's creating a text field, submit date, okay. It should be a date field, I guess. Is it date field? No, it's just text field and submit date. So maybe someone will give manually enter a date, not selecting, okay. Then, okay, variable today is new. Okay, this one you need to remember. Whenever you want to set current date anywhere, okay, any script, any functionality, if you want to set current date from script, this one you do. New date provides you the present date, okay. And then we're taking into this today variable. Then, oh, it's defaulting a field, okay. Which field is it defaulting? Field 4. Oh, this text field is defaulting to the present date, okay, good. It's defaulting to present date and also date on time of the day, okay. Even time of the day will be shown there. If you don't want time of the day, just remove this part. Okay, you just remove this part, only the date will be shown without the time. Okay, and then, okay, what are you doing? Display type inline, okay. So nobody can edit this. Yeah, obviously, you want to set current date and you don't want any user to change the date. Okay, so it's inline, so it's uneditable now. Then what is it doing for this portlet object? Okay, setting a submit button, good. And then he says, NLAPI resolve URL. So it's nothing but when someone clicks that button, watch what should happen. When someone clicks the button, okay, suitlet is called, there's a suitlet internal ID, and there's a suitlet deployment ID, okay. What is deployment ID, you might think? If you go back to suitlet, get into any suitlet, view, deployment, here, this is the deployment ID, okay. This deployment ID and this is a script ID. So you do you write suitlet record type, okay, suitlet is record type, and then the script ID, deployment ID, and then the label of the button is submit, obviously. Now what happens? There's a suitlet, okay, this portlet is calling a suitlet. We also have suitlet. I'll show you the suitlet, okay. What this suitlet function is doing, this is our suitlet. When the button is clicked, okay, it's getting get method, as I showed you in the last class. Suitlets we write like this, okay. Request.get method post, okay. What is he doing? Request.get parameter select date, okay. So what all fields we have created in the portlet, he's getting the values, okay. Log expression is getting the selected date, he's getting this account, he's getting this account, this angel account, okay. He's getting all those three accounts which are custom lists. And then the enable, okay, is it enable or disable, is getting even that, the checkbox thing. And then the date, okay, date is current date, obviously we are setting that, the portlet is set by default. Okay, is getting all these values, and then is performing his business logic. Let's see if we can find any business logic that you'll understand. It's creating a record, okay, creating a custom record, that's good, okay, it's creating a custom record. And he says, okay, if this field is not empty, okay, you might think, what is this empty? There will always be this is a function, okay. Function, and what is it then? This function, you're sending the value here, parameter, and if the value is equal to null or blank, okay. In NetSuite, the blank might be just a blank space or NULL, so that's why we're using this is empty function, okay. And over here, if that field value is empty, it's not empty, okay. This is empty, and you're putting not here. Okay, exclamatory. So if the field value is not empty, in the custom record, set that value to a field. Good. Same thing, doing for all these three. Then on the custom record, is in setting selected date, enable submitted date. See, submitted date is nothing but the date you are setting by default on the portlet. And then is submitting the record. Good. So now you understood what's happening. The portlet is created with fields. Some user will enter the fields and click submit. Then a suitlet will be triggered. Suitlet takes all the fields that user entered, and then it's creating a custom record here with those field values. And at the end, what it's doing after creating the field, after creating the custom record, it's calling a schedule script. See, it's calling a schedule script and it says sending some parameters. What is the parameter? It's the record ID. Okay, whichever custom record is created, that record ID is passing as parameter to schedule script. And forget about schedule script, it will have a huge logic, it will have a lot of logic, okay. And oh, here's something else, okay, what is it doing? Schedule script is triggered, and then schedule script performs a function, and if something is returned back, it will come into this variable, okay. And then is okay, taking variable HTML blank, and okay, if status is queued, okay, if schedule script is queued, okay, schedule scripts don't trigger instantly, because if the queue, okay, you need to know what is queue. In NetSuite, we have queues for schedule scripts. Where is schedule script? Okay, this is schedule script. Go to deployments. Open the deployment of schedule script. Only for schedule script will have queues. Oh, good. Honeycomb doesn't have queues. So Honeycomb has only one queue. But most of the clients, they have multiple queues, because if you have only one queue and you have multiple schedule scripts, only one will run. Other cannot run. So one queue can be used by only one script at a time. Remember that. So see here, Honeycomb doesn't have a queue. It has only one queue. So if Honeycomb has two schedule scripts running at the same time, they won't run. Only one will run. The second will have to wait. And if second waits for a long time, then it will be failed and it will throw an error. Okay. So that is why most of the clients, most of the users have multiple queues. Okay. So when you have multiple queues, if you have three queues and you have three scripts, it's better to go to the script deployment and set the queue, okay? And so each script is using each queue. But if you have three queues and you have 30 scripts, obviously you have a lot of schedule scripts. And no company will have more than 5 to 10 queues, okay? So even if you have 10 queues, you have 50 scripts, schedule scripts. How will you manage? Certainly you'll put Q1 for 5 scripts, okay? Then what happens if Q1 is set for 5 scripts? So only one of these 5 scripts will run at a time. The rest of the scripts will be waiting in the queue. So that status queued, when the schedule script is called and if it's queued, that's what we see in the status. Then what is it doing? If it's queued, if enable, okay, this enable is true, okay, in the custom record we said something, right? Enable true, okay. If enable is true, to this HTML variable we are passing your submission has been recorded for this thing, else record has been disabled. Okay, yeah, if this enable is unchecked, it's mean disabled, right? So it's disabled. That's what it shows if it's queued. Okay, if it's not queued, status is not queued, if it's processing or deferred or failed or something else, then what's happening? Okay, then this HTML is showing another submission is currently in progress, please resubmit your request later. Okay, that's what it says. And what's happening, this message, it's showing out response dot write. Okay, so when the user clicks that submit on portlet, within milliseconds, microseconds, the suited script is called, it creates the custom record, and then it calls the schedule script, and after calling, okay, schedule script is triggering, it should return something back to the suitlet. If it returns processing or wait pending or queued or failed or canceled, it may be any, okay? If it's queued, then it's saying, okay, your record has been submitted, and that's enabled. If that's disabled, we are giving the message, hey, your record has been disabled, okay? And then if it's any status other than queue, then what we're doing, we are just showing this message, hey, another submission is in, not another submission, okay, your submission is currently in progress. Oh, no, it says another submission is currently in progress, please resubmit your request later. That's what it says, but it might work, okay? Because status might be even processing. If it's processing, which means this call to schedule script is working. Whatever schedule script has the logic, it will be running, okay? It will be triggering. So if it's even the schedule script is working, even then the user will see this message. And then you can just close the page and you can go to home or do something else, okay? So this is a portlet script. So if someone asks you in the interview, what are portlet scripts? You'll say, okay, portlet script nothing but you create a portlet object where a user can you provide some fields for the user, he can enter values, and at the back end you can make use of those values he entered in a suitlet, and you can perform your business logic. Okay, so that's about portlet scripts. And the portlet which you are creating, it can be used, you can give it to every user. Mostly you won't give it to every user, okay? It will be for few user or a particular role. So how do you do that? How do you give that access to only a particular user? So when you go to portlet script, not portlet script, any script, okay? Any script, when you get into deployments, okay, let's get into deployment of any script. you'll see under audience all roles and all employees. So whenever you create a script, you create a script record, attach the file, given the function, go to deployment, okay, deployment sales order, and you say, okay, status is release, not testing. Okay, testing means it will be work only for you. Release means it works for everybody in this Honeycomb instance, in this NHUD instance, okay, NHUD account. So you put released, you click deploy true, you may give ID or you may not give ID, then you save. But after saving, you again need to go to that script, get under deployment tab, click on the each and every deployment, you open the deployment, and you always need to make sure, okay, deployed and released, you already gave there. You need to come here, log level 2, if you have log levels, and in the log, what kind of log level you have, but debug. If I showed you some logs, right, in this script, in every script, is there a log here? Yeah, it's a log, see, log always starts with debug, so debug logs will be shown. So every time when you write a log execution, make sure you always give debug, okay? And other types of debug, error, and system. System it's not, it's only for system errors. And error is, if you think there will be an error, then you can write that. But mostly when you are just checking, debugging your script, it's debug, okay? And then, if you debug as log level, then execute as role, you always execute as admin. So what happened, why is this execute as admin? Because this script, it's released for everybody, right? So a person in some role, shipping role, is has done something and your script triggered for him, okay? And if your script is doing something, like it may be creating an invoice, okay? If it's creating an invoice, okay? But that shipping role, in that role permission, shipping role doesn't have create invoice permission, right? And that role person triggered this script, it's creating invoice, it will throw an error saying, hey, you don't have enough permissions. So that's why to overcome that, what we do is, we always say execute as role is administrator. So if whenever you put a inside a script, inside a deployment, you put a administrator as under execute as role field, any role, from any role, any person can run this, I mean not run, can have this functionality, this script functionality. So it's that. His role, if shipping role doesn't have invoice creation permission, but still if shipping role person has triggered this script, I mean, he has done something so that the script is triggered, then even though he doesn't have the permission, if the script is executing as admin, then certainly administrator has every rights, right? Administrator has full access, he can do anything. So there is no restriction for administrator. So that's why we set administrator in this script deployment, so that the script, which is released for each and every user, each and every role, will run without any limitations, okay? Without any role limitations. And then you give this to, if it's a schedule script, you do make sure you select a queue for that. And then always click this, all roles, all employees, always, okay? Remember, always click this all roles and all employees. Only if, okay, in such some scenarios, okay, you want this functionality only for particular role, okay? They'll say, hey, we want this functionality only for these two roles. Then what do you do? They're saying, okay, two roles, then edit, under roles, you select those. You may feel, where is that? Okay, you click on edit, see how it, okay, roles, you see all the roles. So you remove this, you select only these two roles, okay? Select one role, click on control and select all role, select them, okay? And when you select a role, you don't need employees, you just save it. So all those people who have these roles, they can execute the script. The script will run only for them, okay? Or else if someone says, hey, this should run only for this person, then this is not required. So select all and select, okay? Then if they say, okay, only checks V should be running this script, only this script should work only for him, then click here and click save. So it will be running only for him, okay? So these things remember. So when you are creating portlet, obviously portlet, a single portlet will not be used by everybody, okay? That doesn't make sense. So a portlet might be used by any individual user. So if you want to give it for only that particular user, it's simple, just come here, select that user and save it. Or if you want to give it to any particular role, simple, then just come here, edit the deployment and select whichever role has to get that portlet access. Okay, this is about setting a script to a role or an employee or everybody. But when there's no specification that it should go to this role or this employee, it means it should be executed for everybody, every role. Then all the time, don't forget, you need to give all roles, all employees. Don't forget, don't worry about all others, okay? Subsidiaries, group, department, partners, take it easy. all not required. The only thing we are concerned with is roles and price. That's it. So every time do check all these both unless there is a criteria. Okay. So this is about portlet scripts. Good. Next we'll look at mass update scripts. That's what we thought, right? So mass update script. What are mass update scripts? Okay. Let me give you an example. Let's go to record types. Okay. Record types. Okay. We have Abbas test record. I guess I even explained to you guys this thing. Oh wow. Last time we've seen there were three records. Now there is only one record. Good. Let's look at any other. We do have 13 minutes. Good. That's enough. More than enough. Customization, record types. Mass updates are mostly used on custom records. At least I've used only on custom records. I've never used it on any transactions. Okay. Even you can use it on transactions, but that's a very rare occurrence where you'll be asked to write a mass update script for any transactions or employee or any customer data. Mostly you'll be doing for yourself, okay? Mass update script you'll write it for yourself. You've been given any requirement, and in that you have a custom record and you're testing it, okay? You do your testing, and then you are giving it for user testing, and you don't want any records to be present inside the custom record. You want to delete all those. And you have thousands of records. You can't go to each and every record and delete, right? So then you use mass update. Like cars. Okay, let's see how many cars here. Good. Go for Kavali movie. I doubt if you went or not. That's why it's a problem. Okay. So here you see this custom record has four records. It's easy. Okay, you can go to edit and delete it, or else you do edit here and here you delete it. But what if there are 1,000 records? Tens of thousands of records. You can't go to each and every record. It will take hours and weeks and days, and it will take ages. So that's why what we do is, okay, if you have a custom record, you want to delete custom all the records, you write a mass update script. Okay, how do you write mass update script? Simple. Just one line. This script is used to delete all the records of whichever custom record this script is deployed on. Simple. So there's a function, mass update, record type, record ID, okay? And then NLAPI delete record, record type, and record ID. Simple. Let's try an example. We have 10 more minutes. So let's save this one. Save as. I'll go to desktop. I'll say, okay, mass UPD, okay, .js. And I'll save this file. Okay? Now let's do this. Let's find any custom record which has at least 10, so that you can satisfy your ego. Zahir did create at least 10. Let's see if someone else created at least 10 MSET marks. That's interesting. Oh, it's again Zahir. I doubt whether he created 10. Oh, good. This time he has 11. Oh, he has 12. Okay. So now let's delete all these 12 records. Here I'm showing 12, but most of the times there may be thousands of records. Okay. How to delete it? What is it? It's called MSET marks list is the record. Okay, let's create a mass update script. Scripting, scripts. Okay, we want a new script. Okay, now first take the script file. So update the script file. Come on. Don't take too long. Oh, sorry. My bad. Okay, choose file, go to desktop. On desktop, what was that? Mass, right? MASS, mass upd.js. Open this and then file name. Okay, give it the same file name. Make sure it's better you all have the same file name, upd.js. Okay, and save it. Okay, it's saved now. Create script record 1.0 mass update script. Okay, okay, we are testing. Test mass update script. Anything. ID is fine. Let it take whatever you want. Script is there. What is the function? Maybe give some function, right? Mass update. Control C. Control V. Okay, now we are saving this. But we need to deploy it too. Again, I edit. Forgot deploy. Under deployments. Okay, what was that MSET, right? EAMCET. Good, we got it. So everything will be here. Sales order, invoice, everything, JE, all your custom records, everything will be in this list. Okay. MSET marks. People are testing fine. I'm doing it. If you release it, then everybody can do it. Okay, save this. So it's deployed currently on MSN Max. Now, how to run it? Lists, mass update, mass updates. Okay, open this one. Here you have custom updates. Click on this. See, you have MSN Max. We've deployed a script called test MUS on MSN Max. Click on test MUS. Okay, then it will show you kind of save search. First, you do preview. You can do save or something, but let's do a preview and see. Okay, so that custom record has 12 and all are selected. You can even uncheck if you don't want this to be deleted. Okay, let's select all this. And now, when you say perform update, okay, it's complete and has successfully performed on 11 records. You click okay, come back. Okay, now let's go to the record type. So we did a mass update. Our mass update was to delete all the records. Where is that MSET? EAM. Okay, we got here MSET Max. Let's look at the list. Good, all are deleted. So this is mass update. So I just show you for 11 records, but if in any situation you need to delete like thousands of records, hundreds of records, then you just use this simple mass update. Okay. So if you look at this recording, and then you'll understand clearly, then you can remember and practice it, how to do mass update. Okay. So that's it for today. Let's wind up today. And we still have two things left. We need to look at workflows and then workflow action scripts. I guess we don't need 1 hour for that. We can wind it up in half an hour tomorrow. So tomorrow would be our last class. And don't worry, even after tomorrow's class, if you have any doubts, you can always send me emails and you can send me a message. I don't have my number, but fine, you can send me an email. I'll contact you guys. Contact you and then I'll clear all your doubts. Okay. So thanks, guys. Hope you started your assignment. I'm planning to provide one more assignment. I'll put all rest all topics that we've seen in one more assignment so that at least you'll have once or practice once on all each and every topic. Okay, guys. Have a good night and see you all tomorrow. Yeah, good night.